Hello, and today we're in Covent Garden. The reason we're here is to talk about the theme of growing conflict and ambivalence that Alexander Herzen felt in relation to the wider revolutionary movement. This theme becomes explicit here on this site in Covent Garden, on the corner of Endell Street and Longacre, because of a building that used to stand here. In the latter half of the 19th century, on this site here, where this beige office block is, stood St. Martin's Hall. St. Martin's Hall was a famous public venue for conferences, concerts, and lectures. And indeed, in 1864, it was the site of the foundation of the first international of the working men's movement, which continued to meet here up until 1872. In 1864, it was also the site where the celebrity Italian revolutionary Garibaldi came and was feted by the London public on his tour around the British Isles. But the event I want to focus on occurred here in February 1855. In February 1855, a man called Ernest Jones, one of the leading figures in the British Chartist movement, decided to organise a celebration and commemoration of the 1848 revolutions. And he decided to have a programme consisting of speakers from all the different revolutionary groups who were based in London at that time. He was in a very good position to do this because, of course, in the 1850s, because of the backlash against the 1848 revolutions, all these different revolutionary groups were represented here in the city. He thought of this as an event for all the peoples of Europe, and in many ways it's a forerunner of the first Communist International. To represent the Russians, he invited, of course, Alexander Herzen, who was the leading Russian revolutionary figure in the city. And to represent the German workers, he invited a man who at that stage wasn't as famous as Alexander Herzen, but of course would become much more famous later on, one Karl Marx. Now, Marx initially jumped at the chance to appear at this event with alacrity. But once he heard that Herzen was going to appear, he changed his mind and refused to appear on a platform with the great Russian figure. In order to understand why there was this conflict, and in fact this actual antipathy between Herzen and Marx, we have to understand a little bit about their background theory and their approach to the socialist movement. Marx famously was a scientific socialist, and what that meant was that he believed that socialism, or the socialist revolution, would occur out of a process of clearly defined, historically determined stages and conditions. Herzen profoundly rejected this whole paradigm for revolution on the basis that Herzen believed that you couldn't sacrifice generations through a process in order to achieve some abstract resolution of history in the ultimate degree, at the end of a process. He saw that as inhuman. The other aspect of contention between them was that Marx believed in a centralized, disciplined committee control over the workers' movement. Whereas Herzen, of course, was already running the Free Russian Press at this time, and his whole policy was based on the idea of reflecting all aspects of opinion and basically adhering to an idea of pluralism in relation to the revolutionary movement. However, the fundamental bone of contention between Marx and Herzen was to do with Marx's objection to the theory that Herzen had been developing at least since 1848 on the principle that it would be the Russian peasant communes which would form the basis for a socialist future, not just for Russia, but provide a model for the world. As far as Marx was concerned, this was what he called quote unquote rural idiocy. And when asked to come and speak at this event in St. Martin's Hall, made a particular point in relation to Herzen and his theory by saying that I do not believe that old Europe can be rejuvenated by Russian blood. So the two men had no theoretical basis for a consensus and were not able to appear on the same platform. And in this case, it was Marx who withdrew. But what this event shows is a wider theme that will go on to develop in Herzen's life, in that he was beginning to feel more and more conflicted and ambivalent in relation to the wider revolutionary movement. In this case, of course, this event is a manifestation of the problems he had with the foreign emigres who were here in London in the 1850s. But as we shall see, as this film develops, that problem tragically also develops in relation to his own countrymen. Hello, we're here today in this rather convenient spot overlooking the Finchley Road in the area of Swiss Cottage. When Alexander Herzen was a teenager, a very famous event occurred when he made an oath up on the Sparrow Hills, which overlook Moscow, and he made an oath to continue the quest and the crusade, if you like, of the Decembrists to bring about a liberal and tolerant regime in Russia. In a very Russian way, though, Herzen didn't do this as an individual. He did it with his closest friend in life, a man called Nikolai Agorov. And they devoted their lives as teenage boys to creating a better Russia, a better future for their country. And these two young men remained close friends throughout their lives. And when they were together, they were inseparable. However, later on in life, they were separated by circumstances when the Tsarist authorities arrested them both. And it was a forced separation. But when Herzen left Russia in 1847, never to return, he made a point of keeping in touch with Agorov. And indeed, when he arrived in London in 1852, almost immediately he was pleading with Agorov to come and join him in London. Now, the reason Herzen was particularly keen for Agorov to come and join him was not just because he wanted to see his old friend again, but because he was aware of Agorov's personal circumstances back in Russia, and also in connection with some of his own personal circumstances. First of all, on the point about Agorov's personal circumstances, well, Agorov had had a rather difficult marriage and was separated and estranged from his wife, and he'd formed a relationship with a woman who was considerably younger than him, Natalia Tuchkova. The problem was that his wife wouldn't give him a divorce, and for a man to be having a mistress who was also from the same aristocratic Russian circles as himself was profoundly frowned upon by Russian society. The radicals like Herzen and the rest of his circle, of course, lauded Agorov for pursuing love and his personal feelings in this way. But in Russian society, it was totally unacceptable.
And of course, the other dimension to this was that Ugarov was a radical poet, and the Tsarist authorities were constantly monitoring him anyway. So when Herzen was set up in London, he wanted to give his friend the chance to come and breathe in a freer society where they could express themselves freely, which he knew that he couldn't do back in Russia. But the other dimension to this is, of course, that Herzen himself had gone through a very severe emotional and personal crisis before arriving in London. You will recall on an earlier part of this film that when he arrived in London, he isolated himself away in Primrose Hill because he wanted to get away from the revolutionary circles because of a drama that had unfolded in his personal life on the continent before he arrived. Well, in order to understand the background to that drama, we need to go back to the winter of 1848-49 in Paris. In 1848, Herzen had been deeply disillusioned by the revolution that had taken place in Paris, and he found a soulmate in a young man called Georg Herwig, a German poet. Georg Herwig and his wife became very close friends of the Herzen family at the end of 1848. And this was because Herzen was attracted to Herwig because Herwig had also suffered from the failure of the revolution. And that relates back to Herwig's an escapade that had occurred with Herwig earlier in the year in 1848. But just to give you a little bit of background about Herwig, Herwig was from quite a humble background, but he was a strikingly good-looking man who also had this reputation as a great romantic poet. And because of that, he bagged himself a very rich wife. And this wife, Emma Herwig, was very keen to bankroll all aspects of his lifestyle without ever stinting him in anything. And she was also keen to promote his image as the great romantic revolutionary poet. And thus it was actually Emma Herwig who paid for Georg to lead a German Republican Legion in Germany to ally themselves with a revolutionary group in Baden in the middle of 1848, at the height of the great revolutionary year. In the event, the Georg Herwig's Legion was on its way to meet up with other revolutionary groups in order to go and attack anti-revolutionary forces in Baden, but the forces they were expecting to meet never materialized. And in this scenario, they decided to retreat. Unfortunately, during their retreat, a group of regular soldiers caught up with them and a battle ensued and some 50 men were killed. And Herwig and his wife had to flee for their lives. They managed to get back across the French border and arrived back in Paris, but Herwig, as leader of this operation, was being held responsible for the catastrophic failure of this military adventure. And in a context where he felt humiliated after this ignominious military exercise, he was looking for someone who would give him a sympathetic ear. And at the same time, Emma Herwig's father, who basically was the source of all their money, had decided to cut their allowance. So they weren't able to live in quite the style that they'd become accustomed to. And it's against this background of wanting to be in a more luxurious environment and needing to have a sympathetic ear for their sense of failure over the 1848 revolution, that they became very close friends and regular visitors to the Herzen household in Paris. It's one of the great ironies of Herzen's life that it was Alexander Herzen himself who was attracted to Georg Herwegh. The attraction was based on two elements. One, that Herwegh himself was a very weak, needy character who looked up to Herzen, and this undoubtedly to a degree flattered Herzen's paternalistic pride, and he was pleased to take this young poet under his wing. But the other aspect of the attraction was that Herzen himself had been deeply disillusioned by the revolutionary events of 1848, when the Parisian middle classes had allied themselves with the French National Guard in order to shoot down the workers who were demanding that the revolution be a socialist revolution. And in Herwegh and this event where he'd led the German Republican Legion, he saw a man who had a spirit of bold, expressive freedom as an individual, but also pursued a social ideal. And this chimed in very much with Herzen's own view of what the revolution should have been about and what it had failed to be about. So he looked upon Herwegh as this boldly expressive character. So Herwegh, for Herzen, represented almost the only continental European, Western European, who had escaped the corrupt, petty bourgeois world that he'd seen triumph in Paris in 1848. And indeed, Herzen even went as far as to say that Georg was the only Russian in his Paris circle, meaning that Herwegh had what Herzen called a personality, that he was able to go beyond the banal, trivial, materialistic worldview and form of civilization that Herzen had discovered was triumphing in Western Europe. But as I said, the personal aspect of the attraction for Herzen was that Georg Herwegh had an almost childlike neediness and dependence on people around him. And that excited Herzen's paternalistic instincts. But unfortunately and tragically for Herzen, it also excited Herzen's wife. Now, the background to this is perhaps that Alexander Herzen was a profoundly independent man, a very self-contained man, a very driven man who knew exactly what he wanted in life. And in many ways, those around him, like his wife, much as he loved them, were still satellites to his own world. And it's the feeling is that with Natalia Herzen, that she didn't really feel any sense of calling in the relationship. But with Georg Herwegh, she did feel a sense of calling, because he opened up to her and gave her almost a sense of maternal protectiveness to him, as well, of course, being an extremely handsome man who attracted her on a physical level. And this led to them starting an affair, which at least on her side was a very passionate and heartfelt undertaking. One of the things that made this triangular relationship doubly complicated was the fact that all the romantic radical circles were committed to the ideas of the French philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau, or Swiss-French philosopher, I should say. And Jean-Jacques Rousseau had famously propounded the idea that human beings should follow their hearts, that their feelings were much more important than both reason and any conventions of society. And this high priest of the religion of sentiment was deeply embedded to the world views of Natalia Herzen, Herzen himself, and all of their circle. The problem was that, of course, when Herzen was confronted by the fact that his wife had exercised or participated in the highest sacrament of this religion of sentiment by pursuing her love with a man apart from her husband, he found it much more difficult to cope with. So how did the affair itself come about in practical terms? Well, in 1849, the French Second Republic government started to crack down on all the revolutionaries who were still scattered across France, but mainly concentrated in Paris. They were imprisoning, exiling, and or deporting various individuals. And they very quickly turned their attention to the foreign revolutionaries who were still in Paris. And at this point, both Herzen and Herwig got very nervous about the situation, and they decided to decamp with their families to the safety of Switzerland, to Geneva. Well, Geneva, of course, was the birthplace and the original home of Jean-Jacques Rousseau. And Natalia Herzen was able to see the famous Rousseau Island in the middle of Geneva when she started reading Rousseau's famous novel, La Nouvelle Héloïse, which of course is all about the necessity to pursue love against any kind of social convention. And in this heady atmosphere of Rousseau's ideas, one day in the summer of 1849, going for a walk in the mountains in Montreux with Herwig, she was moved to start a physical affair with him. Herzen had no idea that this was going on, and indeed in October 1849, Natalia Herzen actually conceived a child. Herzen still had no suspicions, which obviously implies that she was still having normal relations with her husband at the same time. She had a miscarriage in the November, and in the December, Herzen decided that he needed to move on, and the party broke up, and they moved on to Zurich. Well, in January of the new year, 1850, Herzen had to go to Paris on various business matters. And when he was in Paris, he called in on Herwig's wife, Emma Herwig, and she was complaining bitterly that she felt that Georg had been neglecting her. He wasn't there at the time. And shortly after that, Herzen received some a batch of letters from his wife praising Herwig to the skies and saying what a wonderful friend he was. And at this point, he started to have some anxieties. He immediately put pen to paper to express these anxieties to his wife, and that led to her immediately coming to Paris and reassuring him. And in fact, they had a new sort of second honeymoon in Paris in the spring of 1850. And Natalia fell pregnant again, this time definitely by Herzen. Indeed, Herzen was so reassured by the fact that Emma had come to see him and obviously hadn't told him the truth, that he himself contacted the Herwigs again and asked them to come and join the Herzens in Nice. And The Herwegs indeed did this, and in November 1850, Herzen's daughter Olga was born, and in a matter of 2 weeks after the birth of his daughter, Natalia Herzen re-engaged with her affair with Herweg. This time, her passion overcame her discretion, and in fact, in January 1851, Herzen finally realized what was going on. Herzen was deeply conflicted about the revelation of his wife's affair, because on the one hand, as a romantic radical, he adhered to the Rousseauian principles of following one's heart and the importance of sentiment in life. But as the husband of the woman who was having the affair, he was experiencing emotionally what he called quote unquote black treason in his own heart. However, true to his principles, he gave Natalia a choice. He said, if you want to go with Herweg, you can. But if you choose to stay with me, I insist that Herweg leave Nice and that you never see him again. Natalia chose to stay with her husband and persuaded Herweg to leave the city. But the real problems started subsequently, because the only way that Herzen could cope with the revelation that his wife had had this affair was to basically abdicate her from any responsibility, to convince himself that she had no complicity in it and that in fact she'd been led astray by Herweg. And not only did Herzen convince himself of this, but he started to disseminate this story amongst the radical revolutionary circles. Well, it wasn't long before Herweg heard that this is the line that Herzen was taking. And later on, Natalia fell pregnant again by Herzen. And at this point, Herweg himself was so incensed and felt such a jealous defensiveness about his own reputation as a leading poet of the Romantic revolutionary movement, that he launched a campaign, a war of words, against what Herzen was doing, and started to disseminate the story that in fact Herzen had betrayed all the liberal enlightened principles that they as Romantic revolutionaries were supposed to adhere to, and had coerced his wife back into marriage, and in fact had deprived her of the man she really loved. And this grew into a European-wide cause celebre. All the European radicals and revolutionaries were talking about it because Herzen and Herweg were such notable figures. Herzen was completely occupied with defending his own reputation, but of course his wife was suffering deeply over this situation, because she still believed that her affair with Herweg had been the sacrament of a Rousseauian religion of sentiment, something pure and good. But it was turning into a cauldron of bitterness and rancor. And later on that year, in November 1851, a tragic event hit the Herzen family when Herzen's mother and disabled son were drowned in a ferry disaster off the coast of Nice. And this disaster, combined with the ongoing war of words between Herweg and Herzen, led to Natalia becoming seriously ill during the latter half of her pregnancy. And in fact, in April 1852, she gave birth 2 months prematurely to Herzen's son, and the boy died shortly afterwards, Natalia wasn't told, but she herself then expired a few days after that. As I said earlier, Herzen came to London in order to escape from the conflict on the war of words that he was having with Herwegh, but also to give himself time to grieve for his wife. And also he felt that his political ideals had crashed and burned to such a degree that life was over for him. And when he moved to Primrose Hill, he saw this as a kind of refuge from the revolutionary and radical world, somewhere where he could isolate himself from all of that. But he did send letters to his old friend Agaroff, because he needed Agaroff's moral support at that time. And eventually, much later, Agaroff did arrive. On the 9th of April, 1856, when Herzen was living in a semi-detached house here on the Finchley Road, a cab pulled up, heavily laden, outside the door. And it was finally Agaroff and his mistress, Natalia Tuchkova. And that house stood on the site of the McDonald's that you can see here on the Finchley Road on the other side there. Well, unfortunately, the arrival of his friend and his mistress was not the end of Herzen's emotional troubles and domestic upheaval, because history repeated itself, but this time Herzen was in the role of the perpetrator as opposed to just the victim. Because not long after Agaroff and Tuchkova moved in, Tuchkova started to feel an attraction for Herzen. This may have been partly based on the fact that Tuchkova had been a very close friend of Herzen's wife, and the two of them were basically worshippers at the cult of Natalia Herzen, who died back in 1852. And this helped Herzen to open up again emotionally as well. And they started a relationship. But of course, the same tragic conflict emerged, in that all of them, as romantic radicals, adhered to that same Rousseauian idea that people should be free to pursue their own emotions and their own sentiments. But of course, Agaroff was torn apart emotionally inside by the fact that his mistress had defected over to his best friend. He made every effort to maintain his love for both of them, but found it extremely difficult and started to hit the bottle, very soon becoming an alcoholic. And this in turn, when Tuchkova and Herzen realized this, caused them tremendous distress. And there was a permanent atmosphere of conflict and tension in the Herzen household, because Tuchkova and Herzen could never enjoy their relationship because they were always so racked with guilt over the fact that their friend and Tuchkova's former lover was in a state of depression that he was hiding, but nevertheless they were aware that he was in a state of depression. And Tuchkova was chronically irritable with Herzen himself, and also chronically irritable with his children. Later on, she's had some children of her own by Herzen, but unfortunately this didn't improve the situation. This didn't stop Agaroff and Herzen collaborating together on what must be the high point of the Free Russian Press, when in 1857, at Agaroff's prompting, they started a regular newspaper, The Bell, which of course made a major contribution to the abolition of serfdom in Russia. But Herzen wasn't destined to have any domestic happiness despite his success with his Free Russian Press project. And as we shall see, as this film develops, Again, it's an example of where Herzen's ideals ultimately either failed or didn't produce any of the happiness or the harmony which he dreamed of and adhered to them for.
Hello, and today we're on Putney High Street. The reason we're standing here on Putney High Street is because very close to the site where we are now was the house that Alexander Herzen lived in for the first time for a sustained period of time. He lived in a house near here from 1856 to 1858. The house that he lived in was actually set back from Putney High Street and had a large courtyard in front of it. And the site of that courtyard can be seen from here, was where this large red brick building is on the high street where Tesco Express is. Now, as I say, the house was actually set back from the high street, so we can't see the house, this actual site of the house itself. So we're going to move to another position for the second section of this film, actually onto the site where the house was. But just before we do that, the other point that I would like to make while we're here is that in all the previous Herzen studies and Herzen historiography, the exact location of this house has never been precisely pinpointed. And that's quite surprising because the Putney House was a major chapter in Herzen's life here in London. But I'm pleased to be able to say that, courtesy of the Wandsworth Borough Council Library Archive Services, I have managed to locate the exact location of the house. And we're going to move over to that exact location now for the second section of this film, which gives us the added advantage of getting away from this busy high street here in Putney.
Well, we're now standing on the alleyway that runs parallel with Putney High Street at the back of the red brick building that we saw on the high street in the first section of this film. And the site where I am now standing was the site of Laurel House, or Mr. Tinkler's house, as Herzen referred to it, when he lived here between 1856 and 1858. As we can now see, this alleyway is a service route for deliveries to the shops on the high street, but also, rather strikingly, there seem to be a number of flats bolted on to the back of the shops in this area, illustrating rather well the tremendous premium on space that there seems to be in London now. The other thing that emerged during my research on this area about this alley is that, unfortunately, during the weekend I was told that it doubles as a public urinal and a place where local drug users drop their needles. But I'm pleased to be able to say it was a much more salubrious place when Herzen was living in his villa here, that was on this site because it was set back from Putney High Street. And as I said, he referred to it first of all as Mr. Tinkler's house and then later on as Laurel House. Now, this has led to some debate as to whether in fact he could have lived in two separate houses here in Putney, but my research would lead me to conclude that the position that Edward Hallett Carr takes on this matter, that in fact both references refer back to one property, is correct. And the clinching piece of evidence in relation to that is the tithe map for 1849, which I accessed in the Wandsworth Library Archive Services. And what the tithe map shows is that one Mr. William Tinkler, Esquire, owned a strip of land that ran from Putney Station, a little bit further from to the south of where we are now, up to a point halfway between the two side roads that come off of Putney High Street, one Disraeli Road just down here that we use to access this alleyway, and the next road on, Verta Road. So the strip of land ran down to a point halfway along the High Street between those two roads that adjoin Putney High Street at right angles. Now, this indicates that indeed it was quite a substantial strip of land, but what I can confirm is that William Tinkler only had two large houses on that site in the mid 19th century, which are candidates for Herzen living in. One of those was Laurel House, and the other one was Grove House, a clearly named house. Now, unless Herzen moved from Grove House to Laurel House without, of course, recording it in any of his correspondence or in his memoirs, and suddenly when he got to Laurel House using the name of the house rather than the name of the proprietor, it's just not, it doesn't seem feasible that he moved. The other house was a named house. I'm sure if he'd have been there, he either would have used that, or he would have used the proprietor's name for both houses. So my conclusion is that Laurel House and Mr. Tinkler's house refer to exactly the same property that stood on this site where we are now. And perhaps the reason that Herzen started to refer to the house by the name of the house rather than the name of the proprietor at a certain point through the period that he was living here is just because he started to feel more settled. As I've already mentioned, he was here for a longer period of time than he had been at any of the other properties that he'd inhabited in London. So perhaps there was a sense of him beginning to put down roots, and he felt a greater affinity for the house and just started to name it after its title, the house title, rather than the man that he was paying rent to for his family to live there. So Laurel House stood on a site at the back of the red brick building that we saw on the High Street. And the house covered the area of the backyards here, where these flats have been bolted on, and came right up to the wall of the reading hall of the library here. And in fact, that is connected with Laurel House, because Laurel House was demolished in 1896 and this was built in 1899. It created the space whereby the library could actually be built. Now, the period of Herzen's time here in Putney was one of the most significant periods of his life, because it was at this time that his fame back in Russia really took off. He had already started to gather some fame based on his journal, The Polar Star. But from July 1857, he was producing his regular newspaper, The Bell. And The Bell made him into a megastar amongst the radicals, the intelligentsia, and even the government circles, a lot of whom were reading it despite the fact that it was an illegal publication. The Bell, of course, was being printed back on Judd Street in Bloomsbury, the site that we saw on the first section of this film, on the corner of the park there. But Herzen was living here and preparing the articles and doing a lot of the editorial work in the house on this site when the Bell started to become so famous. And that led to a rather interesting phenomenon, that a trickle of visitors that had been coming to see him in London prior to the release of the Bell actually turned into a flood. And this flood of visitors were all coming here to the Putney House, to such an extent that in fact the local guidebook for Putney,
for this period in the 1850s actually recorded the presence of Herzen and the location of his house as one of the sites to see in the Putney area. The most important visitor that Herzen had here in his Putney house was a man called Boris Chicherin, who was a law professor at Moscow University and a representative of a liberal circle of legal men out there. And the reason that Chicherin is so important is not so much for the agenda that he presented to Herzen when he came here to Putney, as more what he represents in the development of Herzen's life here in London. Namely, that Chicherin was the very first visitor that Herzen had who gives, who is a sign or a marker of a process that will develop through the next few years. Namely, that Herzen's great ideal of bringing the Russian intelligentsia together in a sense of fraternal vision for the future of Russia would ultimately fail. And the signs that Herzen would not be able to create a consensus amongst the Russian intelligentsia through the exercise of the free press, through the forum of his free publications from London, was manifested in the meeting that he had with Chicherin. We will come back to that point, but before we actually talk about the meeting itself, I need to give you a little bit of background to how Chicherin came to be here. We need to go back to 1856, and in 1856, Chicherin and his liberal circle from Moscow University sent Herzen a huge package of documents and articles in response to the ongoing invitation that Herzen had made to the Russian intelligentsia to send him material that he could publish freely here in London. But what Chicherin and his liberal circle did was to include in that package an open letter addressed directly to Herzen himself. And what they said in that letter was that they were very worried about his line in and his position in relation to the Tsarist autocracy. What Herzen was doing was criticizing the Tsarist autocracy, not in an aggressive revolutionary way at this stage. What he was doing was saying to the Tsar and his ministers that one, they needed to speed up the process of liberating the serfs. But the other issue that he and many others on the left of the political spectrum in Russia were worried about was that if the serfs were going to be liberated, they needed to be given land. There was no point in setting them free if they didn't have any means of making a living for them and their families. So on that basis, Herzen took the line in his publications that if the Tsar didn't liberate the peasants from above, didn't liberate the serfs from above, the serfs would be entitled to liberate themselves from below. And indeed, he even published an article by another author, an anonymous author, who went so far as to say that if the Tsarist autocracy didn't speed up with the process of liberation, the serfs would be entitled to pick up their axes and resolve the problem for themselves. Well, all this sent tremendous shockwaves through the liberal circles around Chicherin, and they, as I say, they addressed this letter directly to Herzen, criticizing him for this. But Herzen, in the spirit of free speech, not only published most of their other articles and manuscripts, but published this letter, this open letter criticizing him himself in the in one of his publications. But of course, Herzen also included a robust defense of his own position in that same edition. When Chicherin and his circle read this these robust responses from Herzen, they felt at that point that they needed to challenge Herzen directly. So they chose Chicherin from their number to come all the way to London, here to Putney, to remonstrate with Herzen directly about his line. And the reason they were doing that is because they thought these criticisms from Herzen were likely to provoke a reaction amongst the Tsarist ministers and advisors. The point was that, of course, a lot of the ministers and advisors around Tsar Alexander II were landowners themselves. So whilst they were prepared to discuss the liberation of the serfs, they were very reluctant to engage with the idea of land reform or land redistribution. So out of fear that Herzen's criticisms would lead to the derailment of the whole reform process itself, Chicherin, Boris Chicherin, arrived here in Putney in September 1858 to talk to Herzen directly. In order to understand the failure of these two men to reach any consensus, we need to examine the nature of their views in a little bit more detail. Both of them were liberals, but in the Russian political context, liberals could be very different things. Chicherin was a liberal, a law professor from Moscow University, as I've said, and his attitude and that of his circle was that they believed in the development of a free market capitalist system in Russia, but they were convinced that that could only happen under the stewardship of the Tsarist autocracy, that the political forces in Russia were too explosive and too likely to fragment and possibly lead to conflict to remove the Tsarist autocracy. So they believed in an evolutionary process towards a free market economy, a capitalist Russia, but under the control of the Tsarist autocracy. Herzen also has a reputation as a liberal, but of course Herzen was a liberal of a very different kind. And in order to understand the nature of Herzen's liberalism, we need to look at the development of his philosophical position. And in order to do that, we need to start back in the what's known as the marvelous decade, the period of the mid-1830s to mid-1840s, when Russian intellectual culture split into two camps. On the one hand, you had the Westernizers, who, as the name suggests, looked to Western Europe as a model for Russia's future cultural and political development. And on the other hand, you had the Slavophiles, who looked to Russia's own native traditions and Slavic traditions as a way of building the country's future. At that period, Herzen was very much a leading Westernizer. He was absolutely committed to the idea that Russia must abandon its outmoded, antiquated structures and look to a modern Western model in order to develop itself. However, something very interesting happened with Herzen. From the moment he left Russia and arrived in the West, never to return, I might add, in 1847, he started to have doubts about the Western European model as a good basis for developing Russia's future. These doubts really crystallized into a clear political, social, philosophical position after the 1848 revolution in Paris. Herzen was absolutely horrified when he witnessed the bourgeois turn of that revolution in the aftermath of the change of power at the top of the French state. As soon as the existing powers had been overturned, as is well known, the French bourgeoisie made an alliance with the French National Guard to shoot down the workers, the proletarian movement, which was demanding a socialist revolution because they weren't going to tolerate any limits on their rights to their property. This deeply distressed and depressed Herzen, and at that point he decided that Western Europe was no model for a socialist future for Russia, and he started to embrace a degree of Slavophile approach to the future of the country, in that he looked to the peasant communes. Now, these peasant communes were the organizations that existed in all the villages across Russia amongst the serfs and free peasants, where the peasants would share not only their tools and equipment, but also their draft animals and their labor. And as Herzen himself says, the point about the peasant communes was that it was socialism without anybody providing a formal definition, without anybody providing a formal philosophy of socialism. And he thought this organic, spontaneous model of socialism was superior. He came to the conclusion that it was superior to anything the West had to offer. And he looked to a future for Russia in which there would be a federation of these peasant socialist communes as a way of capturing the two ideals that were always close to Herzen's heart, namely one that men should live in brotherhood with one another in a state of fraternity, but also that the individual should be valued, that he saw the individual as sacrosanct and feared that a bourgeois form of socialism would actually repress the individual, or a Western, perhaps I should say, form of socialism would actually repress and deny the rights of the individual. But perhaps Russia was able to provide a model that combined these things in a natural, seamless harmony. However, when he started to expound his position to Chicherin, as I've said, the two men were not able to reach any kind of consensus, because as far as Chicherin was concerned, this talk of the theme of preserving the rights of the individual, and along with these ideals of fraternal harmony, all seemed to him highly pie in the sky and idealistic. And Chicherin ultimately accused him of having absolutely no conception of the practical necessities of government. It should be stressed that Herzen didn't naively believe that this federation of socialist agrarian communes would just emerge naturally. Herzen insisted to Chicherin that it was the role of the intelligentsia, like himself and Herzen, to teach the peasants, to go to the villages, to teach them to respect the individual in combination with preserving their own long, organic and spontaneous tradition of living in fraternal socialist harmony that I mentioned earlier. And it's at this point that the really fundamental philosophical difference emerges between Herzen and Chicherin, in that Chicherin and his circle were followers of the German idealist philosopher Hegel. And Hegel famously said earlier in the 19th century that history was a rationally determined process, albeit one that involved the conflict of theses, antitheses and syntheses. But Hegel had insisted that at each period of history, in the circumstances that it was in, it was rational. In his famous aphorism, he said, the real is the rational, and the rational is the real.
And on that basis, he went on to justify the Prussian state as the most rational structure in his country at the time that he was writing. Now, Chicherin and his circle picked up this idea and applied it to the Tsarist autocracy. They were arguing that, yes, ultimately, there would be a resolution of all the historical conflicts and tensions that they believed would resolve themselves in a free market capitalist system in Russia. But at the current stage of Russia's development, the Tsarist autocracy was the authority that could steward that process and was the rational structure in the circumstances. Now, for Herzen, all this talk of Hegel was absolutely anathema. Herzen had thoroughly rejected Hegelian philosophy at an earlier stage of his life for two reasons. One, the idea of justifying what he saw as a corrupt and repressive state was totally unacceptable, but also for the deeper philosophical reason that he rejected the Hegelian idea that the process of history, however much suffering and pain it causes, can be justified as rational so that the people at the end of history can get the benefits. He was unhappy with the idea that a good society could be built on the bones and suffering of all the previous generations. And this is why he continued to insist on his federation of socialist peasant communes, because he thought that they valued the individual at the same time as developing a sense of collective harmony and brotherhood. But the two men coming at the world from these two radically different paradigms couldn't find any consensus. And when Herzen saw Chicherin off at Putney Station in September 1858, they agreed that they respected each other, but they certainly couldn't find any common ground intellectually or in terms of their vision for the future of Russia. A few months after Chicherin arrived back in Moscow, he sent Herzen another open letter, basically reiterating the criticisms that he'd put to him directly when he was here in Putney. He summed it up by saying that Herzen should embrace reason and not passion, and go for evolution, not revolution. Much later on, when Chicherin wrote his memoirs, he claimed that he was the very first Russian to criticize the political direction of the emigre Russian intelligentsia. Now, whilst that may be a slight exaggeration, it is indeed a milestone, this visit of Chicherin to Herzen in Putney, because that sense that, yes, the Russians back in Russia, the Russian intelligentsia back in Russia, had started to criticize what Herzen was doing is very significant for Herzen's future development and life here in London, in the sense that, as I said before, his great ideal of establishing a consensus amongst all parties in the Russian intelligentsia in order to create a springboard, a foundation in which they could build a collective harmonious vision of Russia's future, was shattered by this event. The Free Russian Press, despite all of Herzen's ambitions and ideals for it, in fact revealed that the Russian intelligentsia were deeply fragmented rather than unified in the way that he hoped free speech would facilitate. And this fragmentation sets the scene for the later sectarianism in the Russian radical and revolutionary circles that would lead to Lenin creating a situation where he repressed all other shades of opinion and lays the foundation
for the totalitarianism that we see emerging in the Soviet Union after 1917.